language, so we're not sort of formally introduced the speakers in any great length because it's all in your pack. There's evaluation sheets as well. If you could fill in those evaluation sheets during the day and then give them back to me at the end, I can pick them up. This camera is to video the talks for Facebook. The talks will be going on Facebook Live, and then you'll also be able to access the talks next week. If you go to the TSA, there'll be a website, there'll be a link to the talks. When the talks are finished and there's questions after the talks, so the questions will not be on Facebook, so you don't need to worry in the audience about it being on Facebook. And if anybody doesn't want to be on Facebook, he is actually talking. If you just check, I think Sarah knows the list of who's agreed and who hasn't agreed, so if you're worried about that in any way, just chat to Sarah. So so I'll just hand over then to Louise, and thank you very much for coming.
Thank you. Can everybody hear me? I'm obviously less familiar with the microphone here. So I'm Louise Fish, I'm the new Chief Executive of the TSA, and it's my fourth week in the job. So I'm here really to learn as much as possible from the experts in the room, whether that's the clinicians or the patients and families I know are here today, about TSC, and I couldn't be more delighted with the timing in terms of learning as much as I can very early into the job. So if you see me around, please do come and say hello. It'd be great to meet as many people as possible while I'm in Belfast. I'm here also with Martin Short, our chairman, and with a large number of staff from the TSA, including most of our advisors. We try and make sure that everyone gets to, or we will try and make sure that everyone gets to at least one event a year, just to make sure that we're all keeping our knowledge about TSC up to date, and that means we can give the best possible support to people living with TSC and their families. So we're really excited to be in Belfast today and to have this opportunity to come over and to learn more. And I'd like to thank Claire for organising the day, Deirdre and Patrick for chairing, all of our speakers for taking the time out of what I know are their incredibly busy diaries to come and speak to us here today, and to everyone else who's made the day possible. I wanted to give a special mention to Professor Julian Sampson. You may not know, or some of you may know, some of you may not know, that he last week won the 2017 Gomez Award alongside the TSA's Chris Kingswood. And that award's given internationally in recognition of significant impact on the understanding of TSC in research and impact on clinical care. So congratulations. That's brilliant and really well deserved. I wanted to end really, it's a very quick introduction, not a 15 minutes, because I'm not really been here long enough to pontificate about TSC when I know probably less than everybody else in the room about it, so I'm going to learn a bit more before I give a 15 minute presentation to anybody. But I wanted to end by thanking everyone for coming today. I've only been working at the TSA for 4 weeks, but I already know what an incredible community of people we work with, and what an incredible community I've joined. So whether you're a clinician who's here to learn more and make sure that you have the best possible base of knowledge to support the patients that you're working with, whether you're a residential support or care worker who's working with someone who has TSC and you want to make sure you're giving them the best possible care, or whether you're someone living with TSC yourself or a family member who not only wants to come and learn but also wants to share your expert experience of having the condition, of living with the condition, and kind of giving your knowledge of what matters most to the professionals who are here today. Thank you very much for giving your energy, your time, and your help to improve the lives of people with TSC. And I really hope everyone enjoys the day. Thank you very much.
My pleasure to give the introductory talk, I think, this morning. Thank you to Louise for the very kind introduction. It's great to have her as our Chief Executive. I've been asked to talk about the role of the specialist TS clinic, so I think that's probably me up there at Play-Doh, I think. So I thought it gives me a chance just to say why we have a clinic or how we actually ended up having a clinic. And I know Charlie Shepherd's going to talk a little bit about the historical aspects, so I'll not steal his thunder. But just to remind you, it was really first described by Bourneville in 1880. I know Charlie might tell you there are one or two descriptions before that. Pringle, I don't think it's the crisp, Pringle described this in 1890. And for those of you who are not quite sure what TS actually is, most of you should know, Vogt described his fine triad of heart, kidney, and learning difficulties in 1908. The sort of facial rash that he described as abnormal sedation. So TS is an autosomal dominant inherited gene, and Professor Julian Sampson will talk after me just about the genetics aspect and tell you the differences between the type 1 and the type 2 genes. So it tends to affect different areas of the body. The main problems we tend to see are in the skin, the brain, and the kidney, and epilepsy tends to be one of the most difficult features, along with some behavioural problems. So our speakers this afternoon will address the sort of topics of skin disease and learning problems. So there's a couple of pictures just to sort of show you. Some of you in the audience may actually have some of these features. So I'll not dwell too much on the skin features, as this will be dealt with this afternoon. We've one of the first clinics within the world in some ways, and in Belfast, Professor Alan Stevenson, who was the professor of genetics here in the 1940s, set up his clinic. He was interested in tuberous sclerosis, and in 1948 he started to look at patients. And he was the professor at the time. He was called the professor of social and preventative medicine, but he was really a geneticist masquerading with a sort of fancy title. And he stayed in Belfast until 1958, and then he actually moved to Oxford to form the MRC Genetics Unit. So the Oxford team pretty much had a clinic from 1958. He pretty much moved his TS clinic from Belfast to Oxford. And he was interested in what he called the epidemiology of epiloia, as TS was known in the sort of 1940s and 1950s. And he made one of the first genetic observations. Until the 1940s, it wasn't that clear whether TS was actually a genetic disorder. People tended to be found in sort of institutions with TS, and most of us, if we were left in an institution, probably wouldn't do terribly well if we were put in a corner. But they stopped putting people into institutions for all sorts of strange reasons in the 1940s and 1950s. And in fact, most of them now have been closed down. So when he described the sort of epiloia that he looked at, he said there's certainly a genetic component, and he thought it might be a thing called a recessive gene that couldn't quite be excluded. So here's a picture of the man. It's interesting. I gave a talk in October on the history of genetics, and two people in the audience came up to me afterward and said, yes, we were taught by Professor Stevenson in the 1940s. These were two people in their 70s, I think, and they said, yes, his car used to be outside in front of the Medical Biology Centre, and after his lectures, he would always be fiddling with the distributor to try and get the car started to go back to the Royal Victoria Hospital where he was based. So it's sort of funny, the reminiscences that sort of people have. Here he is, it's a picture of the man himself. He published quite prolifically in the 1940s and 1950s, and you can see there's his paper with Fisher in 1956, entitled The Frequency of Epiloia in Northern Ireland. So it was probably one of the first population studies where they actually looked to see if they could identify cases and learn a bit more about the condition. And it's interesting, I don't know if you can read this sort of paper, there's his sort of final, he thought that about 1 in 150,000 was his guess at the time when he sort of did his population study. Interesting, looking at the language at the time, you know, they talk about adenoma sedation with mild epileptic fits. And there's an interesting column there, sort of the way people's learning difficulties were described as somewhere between imbecile, the feeble-minded, low-grade imbecile, high-grade imbecile. We don't use these terms for patients anymore, but we do attribute them to medical managers, I think, to sort of grade them. So it's interesting, you sort of transfer classification that people have developed to other things just to annoy your managers. But this was his early study in the 1950s. And it's interesting because his successor, his successor's successor actually was a Professor Norman Nevin. And Norman trained in Great Ormond Street, and they didn't know much genetics in Great Ormond Street at the time because they'd really only started to set up clinics in the 1950s. So he spent a year there, and then he moved to the Oxford Genetics Unit in 1966. And he was asked to run the TS clinic there by Alan Stevenson. So he developed his interest in TS, and he published one of the sort of earliest papers on the genetics of TS in 1968. You can see there he is with his colleague W.G. Pierce. It says MRC, Population Genetics Unit, but it was published in January the 15th, and you can see he's just moved to Belfast. So the time he submitted his paper and moved to Belfast, then he continued his informal studies here. So it's quite interesting. Stevenson started the clinic here in the 1940s, moved to Oxford, started one there, trained up a geneticist who then moved here. And in this paper, Norman Nevin described autosomal dominant inheritance, and of course he was right. The evidence was accumulating at that stage that it was a dominant gene that could be passed from parent to child. So you see we have a long history of tumour sclerosis. And Norman had a sort of continued interest. He was appointed a consultant in 1968 because of his work from Great Ormond Street in Oxford. And he was professor of, he got a personal chair in 1975 and retired in 2001. And his interest continued. He sort of helped develop a lot of the screening programs in the 1970s for tumour sclerosis, including CT scanning of the brain. And he continued an informal sort of interest in patients until 1995. And there he is, that's a picture. We always say we can never get a picture of the man smiling. So we finally discovered this one, and my colleagues tell me that's him smiling because he's just got his platinum visa card. Always something made him smile that day. So we took the picture just when he had the platinum visa card. So at that point, we didn't have a sort of formal clinic. We had a great interest and saw a lot of patients with this. But fortuitously, there's a Dr. Charles Shepherd sitting in the front row who spent time working with Manny Gomez, who's the probably the world expert on tumour sclerosis in the Mayo Clinic. And Charlie trained with Dr. Gomez, and there he is, just back, looking at the sort of imbeciles as they're here beside him. The early clinic, there's a young myself there, and Shane McKay, and our secretary, and Hilda Crawford, who's appeared yesterday briefly to see us all the way from Australia. So she was our first sort of TSA funded specialist nurse. So Charlie thought I need to get on and formalise this. They set up the clinic in Craigavon, I think around 1995. Craigavon is in the Southern Health Board, and Charlie discovered that when we were seeing patients from sort of all parts of the province, the local hospital chief didn't like the way of seeing patients from outside the hospital boundaries. So we offered to shift the clinic to Belfast in 1997. So I think that was just where we should really have a 20th anniversary cake, I think. So it's now 20 years since we formally set up the clinic in this hospital. And Charlie started the clinic, but more importantly, developed links with the TSA, originally with Anne Hunt and sort of autism prevalence studies. There's one of Charlie's studies there, you can see he's Manny Gomez, talking about pulmonary tumour sclerosis and a whole series of seminal papers. And we started a database at that point, which is still going, and our current team. It's great to have clinics in Northern Ireland because we can sort of put people on a database and then we know where they are and then we can sort of record details. And so Hilda was appointed at that stage with some startup funding from the TSA. So that really helped our clinic to get started. And then we did our own prevalence study in 2004 and we found about 1 in 25,000 people. We maybe need to redo this now that we've got even better figures. So the good thing about Northern Ireland is that it's pretty hard to escape. So we can generally count everybody and get some fairly current, accurate picture. So it's 20 years since we started. I have two consultants. The best looking one, there's Dr. O'Donnell. So there's a picture of me when I'm slightly younger to show up more hair. Two current genetic counsellors. There's Rachel and Claire, who you've met with sitting in the audience. Our laboratory testing is done by our laboratory assistant down here at the bottom. He's just recently got an award for his good work, and we let him give you a brief talk next on the genetic aspects. But we send all the laboratory tests to Julian in Cardiff, and he's done a great job of sort of recording those. And so we've pretty much got the genetic profile of the Northern Ireland TS population in Cardiff. So thank you to Julian, and again, well done on the award. It's really terrific. And Charlie Shepherd still turns up every month to the clinic just to keep us right. So we've got this sort of system for coordinated care, and this is pretty much how the clinic started. So the advantages, there's a little map of Northern Ireland. The bits from here to here have water, so nobody can really get in this way. This bit here, there's a county called Donegal, which is full of holiday homes for people from all over. There's not much TS there, essentially. And the bit down here borders a health system that costs money. So generally, if you live in sort of white part here, the people generally come to our clinic, and it's not too much to travel, or if they can't, we can go and see them. Our genetic counselor will tell you how many cases we have in the database. We've well over 100 now. It's sort of edging up at 110 or so or more. It functions also as a training clinic. We regularly see trainees from pediatrics, neurology, dermatology, psychiatry, radiology, nephrology who sit in the clinics. And it's great because then they learn about TS, and then we've got friends in high places when they become eminent consultants or clinicians around the province, and they remember us fondly, hopefully, from their training. They know enough that we exist and help patients access. Plus, we have centralised funding for testing and treatment. I think our government has been propped up by the local politicians, so maybe it's a good time for Louise to write to the DUP and ask for more funding for patients in Northern Ireland before they're kicked out. So the clinic acts as focus for teaching as well. We can teach and sort of, we usually have students sitting in. So all the people we've mentioned on the previous slide have been trained, so we've built up these sort of links with people from throughout the province. Research, we sort of slowly accumulate a few papers that we've published in over the last 10 years or so. So it's good just to sort of update people and sort of push things forward in terms of research. Part of the clinic is managing expectations, and probably the behavioural management, maybe one of the most difficult aspects, and we're going to hear maybe this afternoon how to deal with that. Some of the sort of main organ problems, the kidneys get little fatty lumps called angiomyolipomas, so it's good to keep an eye on those, or it's good to keep a check to make sure somebody somewhere is checking these things. Sometimes we try not to duplicate what other people are doing, so the clinic's almost just like a checklist. So if the kidney specialist is looking after somebody particularly well, just keep a gentle check to make sure that they keep doing that. Make sure no problems pop up in the brain. I like this one. Some of you may have already read this. From the point of view of the lower end, Nord lacks many enemas seem to be working well. So for completeness, I arranged complete abdominal filling today, and it also showed no fecal loading. Therefore, I think we need to reduce our expectations of what we expect to see coming out of the body. So this is a letter from a pediatrician who sent in, and I thought this kind of summarizes the it's managing expectations, really, isn't it? So I think that's quite good. New drugs, we'll hear a little bit shortly on how drugs are helpful. They won't cure everybody, and access is currently limited, but Deirdre Donnelly has done a great job of getting people onto everolimus drugs, which helped sort of avoid a lot of the kidney complications. And of course, we're now building up a cohort of patients that we can monitor to see if this is good and could be extended to other organs as well. So generally a good overview just to make sure that the health service is a great thing, but sometimes people just slip through the cracks. So our job is just to spot if somebody's about to slip through a crack and make sure that they don't, and make sure that people get access to the services that they should. So that's really what our clinic does. A couple of key people, Claire was appointed in November as the TS advisor, so it's sort of reprising almost Hilda's role. So we have to thank the TSA very much for helping to appoint her. And she turns up just as a patient advocate in that role for half the week, but also as a genetic counsellor role as well. And she organises fundraising events, so here she is with the other ladies. Is Tara, who was our expert counsellor until recently, until she defected to Dublin to teach them how to run the database in Dublin and improve things. So we sort of export expertise throughout the world. And Hilda Crawford was running a very fine clinic in Sydney until recently as well. So people have travelled from our clinic all over the world, and we're proud that we train people so well. So I'll leave that.